Hello, Duncan Stuart speaking. I'm just doing a record now to cover the period of my career from 1991 to 1997. And up until 1990, I was working at Royal North Shore Hospital, and I put quite a detailed summary of my leading work at that stage, according to others, on the MMA program of clinical peer review. And it was during that period that I happened to read an opinion piece by Don Berwick in the New England Journal of Medicine on the 5th of January 1989, when I was becoming aware that the MMA program was very good at finding, or pretty good at finding, things that went wrong, but we lacked a capacity to fix them. And so I was out searching for what's the latest in quality, and I came across total quality management. And then further review found that Don Berwick in Boston with colleagues had been piloting and forecasting that TQM could be well transposed into healthcare. And that article is still worth reading. It's quite old now, but his vision has turned out to be the reality. So that sent me off immediately to meet Don the next year. I went over to Boston to one of his first NDHP meetings in Boston, a very small meeting in someone's private home, in fact. And I remember being quite in awe of Don because he was such a humble and yet knowledgeable person, a leading light. But he was absolutely my hero at that stage. And I pretty well decided at that time that this was going to be my future. I was going to learn what I could, stay connected with his work in the US, and try to be the change agent that brought it back to Australia. So I came back to Royal North Shore, realizing that my time at North Shore needed to come to an end. I had been very, very pushy as a change agent, getting MMA in, got it accepted by the clinicians against all odds, and that's another story worth looking at if you're interested in the special interview with Alan Wolfe about that. But towards the middle to late 1990, it was clear that I had done my work there. Royal North Shore did not want a full-time person like me transitioning from quality assurance to total quality management. That wasn't their core business. I tried a period thanks to Stuart Spring, as the area director of strategic planning. Yeah, that wasn't my thing. I had this passion now for getting amongst getting TQM going in healthcare. And during the period of running MMA, the Treasury Managed Fund, who were the insurance company for all the public hospitals, a fellow called Ed Dowd, who was an American, used to come along and to all my seminars, which I held every 3 to 4 months. And he became extremely impressed with the work we were doing to try to find errors in healthcare. And he offered to fund my time in helping to set this up. So on reflection, I decided that the most influential place to have this find a home was the Australian Council for Healthcare Standards, which was the accreditation body. At that point in time, I was one of the surveyors, had been for quite a few years. They were absolutely committed to inspection, quality assurance. So I approached David Darby, who was the then chief executive, and said, look, David, I've got this. There's a big change happening around the world in the United States to move from quality assurance to continuous improvement. I think that would be an ideal vehicle. The ACHS would be an ideal vehicle to promote that, and I've got funding for 2 years. How about you make me director of a new program, which will be cost neutral to you, where we will run courses? And David was happy with that, particularly that it was cost neutral. And we then went out, and I realised we'd need a partner, an academic partner, so I approached Ari Rotem, who was then one of the senior executives, perhaps the head of the school, I think, for University of New South Wales health planning, health management section, and explained it to him. He agreed to come on board and offer a joint certificate course, which I would write and run six-month modules, distance learning, and we'd run it across the country and at a nominal fee. But basically, since my salary was covered, any money they made was just to cover, was profit, really. And so we could afford to run it and offer it at a very low cost. People coming to Sydney initially and staying in a residential context for a week at the beginning and a week at the end. We subsequently took it to Adelaide and then to Perth. But it ran for the 2 years, and after the funding ran out, I thought that was enough. I mean, I could have kept going there, but I needed to move on to other things as well. And so I didn't push for it to be continued. But in those 2 years, a lot of people came through. The group sizes, from memory, were about 20 people or so. So we covered over, that was one, two, three, four intakes of, well, over, you know, 100 people or more who were the leading quality practitioners across the country, had been through that. And later on, we'll talk to one of them, Sean Spencer from the Royal Children's, who was in the first group. So that was set up. In parallel to that, I decided we needed to show people what this looked like when it was fully developed. And the only way to do that at the time, in a healthcare setting, was to take study tours to the USA, where by 91, 92, hospitals were implementing these programs, 93, 94. So I took four of those under the auspices of the ACHS and one under the auspices of the Australian Quality Council on a user pays basis, and I was the tour leader. And that was another way for me to be travelling to the US as part of my work, but also showing initially quality assurance practitioners, but soon moving on to executives, realising that unless they got it, nothing would change. And certainly the latter tours were medical administrators and then pushing for chief executives to come along. It was all part of a well-thought-out package, and looking back at it now, it was, I think, the most courageous and probably the most changing impact I had in healthcare, where I had this vision and I was going for it. I was very thin on the ground, just me. There wasn't a lot of backup. I brought people in from the US to be my keynote speakers at the distance learning course, people like David Gustafson and many other people who came in and were excellent people, just to talk about examples at this six-month distance learning course, typically at the start and the end of that, so we could get some traction and get some examples. But it was extremely tiring, and probably at the peak of my career, no doubt, for inspiration and creativity and just energy to get things done. So they went back, and you'll hear from Sean later that the impact that made on his life, just to kind of the principles we managed to convey then through the course materials, the assignments, but in particular the visiting gurus who came out and just worked with us for a weekend or a week or two, and really concentrated the mind on what this thing meant, and more so for those who travelled to the US with me on these study tours. So it was an extremely powerful time. The ACHS kept on with their own model for accreditation, but over time there was a shift. Those who were responsible for the accreditation criteria were looking at this. They couldn't not see it, and gradually starting to shift the requirements for accreditation away from purely inspection based, to often with no action, which was very common, to a situation where there was a continuous improvement based on data-driven change in the things that mattered. So that went 91, 92, and I think was instrumental in setting the national scene, which I maintain was the change initiative that moved Australia from quality assurance to CQI, total quality management in healthcare. So by the end of 92, I saw a need to get myself back out of a purely teaching role, back into a hospital operation role. So I was approached by the largest private hospital group in Australia, Chief Executive Barry Catchlover, to become their half-time director of continuous service improvement, which I did as a way of bringing the private sector on board, thinking that they would have the incentives. Did that for several years and then phased into that as the ACH program came to an end in the end of 92. I also took an appointment with the Australian Quality Council, which at that stage were the, by and large, the leaders of total quality management across all industries. Healthcare hadn't really had a place to buy into. It was mainly led by the Kodaks of the world, who were just arranging site visits and looking at... And while there's a lot to be gained from that, there's a lot to learn from going to non-healthcare sites in Australia, particularly the importance of culture. People were still saying they wanted to see healthcare examples, and so the only place to see those in a well-developed format was in the USA. Don Berwick was very helpful to me in identifying the top 12 or so, 15 exemplar sites that were doing this. And so in, I think it was 1991, we held the first study tour to the USA, and I've got I'll show you some pictures of those people who were the pioneers. It was a very hard, jet-lagged, full-on experience. Probably not enough time for rest at the beginning, but those who came back got a lot out of it, although they were pretty exhausted because we had to run it in a way that gave them the maximum content in the minimum time, since their hospitals were not wanting to have this be seen as junkets. They were definitely very hard-working groups, and then on they went. So the series of those two things, the running of the course, the taking of four study tours to the USA, and then I looked for a hospital where I could be a change agent with direct hands-on. And unfortunately, I chose Balmain Hospital, thinking it was a good size, and I went there, didn't do a lot of research on it, and didn't check out the CEO's beliefs, big mistake, and it turned out she wasn't really... a great supporter of it. I assumed I could convert her, but no, that didn't happen. And soon after I got there, independently of my efforts, it was converted to an aged care facility. I decided I wanted to work in an acute facility, so I resigned from that. And round about then, the Commonwealth in 1994 or thereabouts were advertising for an integrated quality management model, which by then, patient safety had become the top agenda across Australia. The publications by the various teams who were screening and publishing in the MJA, the amount of medical errors that were happening had created a climate. And David Dean, to his great credit in the Health Roundtable, used to take the view that you've got to wait until the climate wants things, the CEOs want things like patient safety. Whereas I took a more naive view, impatient view, of trying to get the change happening as a pioneer, which just was much more difficult looking back. And I later learned from David, you've got to wait until they're ready. So we got that going eventually. And so I put in an application to lead a consortium of hospitals who, to me, were amongst the leaders across Australia in various aspects of quality, and won that contract. It was $1 million contract from the Commonwealth. Probably not enough money, too many people, too many players, and it became a little bit, it was very ambitious. But I figured that we get one shot at this, and if I put in a bid that was too high, it was unlikely to be successful. So looking back now, the mistake made was not to, first of all, get one hospital as the exemplar site, which should have been the Royal Children's Hospital, who were my lead partner in running the whole thing, John DeCampo, to his great credit, who was a client of mine during this period. I was down there every month working with Sean Spencer, as you'll hear in a moment, and that was probably one of the best periods of my life, that combination of working with the Royal Children's Hospital, having clients in Auckland, South Australia, around the country, having succeeded in getting the quality management program running across the country, having got study tours going to the USA, and having got the Australian Quality Council and HCOA, the largest private hospital group in Australia, starting to look at these methods, and a shift happening in the accreditation requirements, that was very much, I think, my direct efforts and probably the most powerful influence I've had on Australian healthcare since then. But because of the ambitious nature of the IQMM, it started in 1996, and many of the hospitals were looking for more money than I had to reward them for efforts. And I kept saying to them, look, we need to do this because it's the right thing to do. If you're doing this just to get the money out of me, I haven't got enough to do that. So it ended up becoming impractical to keep it going. And in 1997, a series of things happened which led to the program being closed and the withdrawal of Royal Children and Children's and myself, which was a very disappointing and disheartening time for me, because I really had hoped that we could get things going. So I then reflected on all of that, and fortunately by mid to early 1997, I stumbled across a guy called Dr. David Dean, who was just getting started with the Health Round Table. They had about five or six members teaching hospitals across Australian states. I'd seen the American version of that, the quality version, which was the Quality Improvement Networks, which were focused purely on quality and were comparing, collaborating, and I'd come back from 1996 determined to start those up. Right, when I saw David's efforts, I approached him and said, why don't we do this together? It seems silly to compete. How about I join you as your clinical arm? He didn't have anybody clinical with him, and he has said in his very kind interview with me that I was the ideal person with my experience to join the Health Roundtable mid-1997 and start the collaboration, initially on cost, initially on that was, because that's where the CEOs were. But over time, over the next 2 years or so, the agenda for safety changed dramatically because of the publication of the error rates that were happening in Australian hospitals. And then the heat was being applied to all hospitals to demonstrate that they had some mechanisms involved for patient safety. So patient safety rose to the top of the pile. We had many patient safety meetings, and so my experience and expertise, and particularly my contacts with the Institute for Healthcare Improvement in the US, became very, very important. And so that allowed further importation of their methods, their breakthrough series methodology, which I'd gone to the US and been trained in, and we ran our first, I ran the first with David, the first breakthrough series, which we call the value improvement process of a collaborating hospitals with one lead site, which we knew was the important thing. And at that stage, it was day of surgery admissions was our first one. Liverpool had pioneered that, working very well. And we did a study tour all around Australia, and I think New Zealand as well, from memory, just to look at how those who were doing it well could teach the rest of us. So that was the start of that. We had a couple more less ambitious value improvement projects since then, but by then, Don Berwick and the IHI were becoming very, very common knowledge in the 2000s, early 2000s. And Don came out to talk at the healthcare conferences, and I had been successful in recruiting about six or seven of his leading disciples, who were practitioners, to come out and talk to my course, and at the same time do various lectures in various places around the country. So that was a that pretty well, in summary, covers the period that I from 1991, when I left Royal North Shore to lead this transition from QA to CQI, right through to mid 1997, when I joined up with the Health Roundtable and became the clinical agent with David Dean, who had a great complementary set of skills in sociology and change management and business, which just was a perfect fit. Stayed there for pretty well 20 years and set up the Regional Health Improvement Network, because that was my initial background as a doctor to work in Roma. So I got the likes of Toowoomba and Bendigo and Ballarat and and places like that and Wagga Wagga to form into a smaller subset of regional hospitals using the same methodologies for the round table. So I ran that for at least 10 years, from 2000 to 2010. Also set up the international round table, which at one stage was to complement the two chapters of the health round table, which at that stage we reached out to places like Saudi Arabia and Singapore, Royal Prince Alfred, Auckland, and a few, Waikato, I think, too, were part of that. And that ran successfully for quite a few years until it became more logical to merge that with the main health round table, which subsequently happened, and I just kept running. By then, I was moving back into about 2006. I was going back. I was missing being a director of medical services. So I went back doing locums in various regional hospitals across the country, and that led to becoming the inaugural or the interim director of patient safety at PA Hospital at the end of 2004, and then moved to Royal North Shore as a locum executive director of medical services from 2005 to June 2010. And in that stage, was able to bring my consulting expertise to Royal Brisbane, which was very much run down. It had been badly affected by the Patel saga, which broke in 2004, and revealed that most of the hospitals in Australia, the doctors just were under supplied, mainly because their salaries were too low. So Uschi Schreiber, who was the Director General, quickly realised there had to be a package to not only to boost the income of all of the salaried medical staff, but also I worked with her tirelessly to convince her that the only way to really get a quick change in rural Brisbane's depleted state of access block, not enough beds, was to do a major consultancy, which I was pushing for a lean consultancy, which I knew had just done something like that in St Vincent's in Sydney, but had to go to tender. And at the end, Accenture, one of the models favoured by the then state government, got the job, came in and did a major review of all the processes at Royal North Shore, and at Royal Brisbane Hospital, and PA Hospital heard about that and they wanted to be added on, so the government funded them to have these two projects running in parallel, which gave it critical mass. Richard Ashby, who had then moved to PA Hospital, accredits that Accenture project, which I kicked off, as being instrumental to the progress that then happened after that at PA Hospital. And so what it did, it basically created the foundation for much of the great work that those two hospitals were then able to do in rebuilding their staffing, rebuilding their recruitment, and rebuilding their systems and processes, which have now become the world-class systems they were. I really do think that had we not done something like that, there could have been ongoing collapses where in 2005, we as the on-call medical executive were being called almost every couple of nights with the emergency department totally on its knees, ramping, and a very, very dangerous situation of patients in corridors with not enough, particularly medical staff, and probably also nursing. And I've been back there as a patient in the last year or so, and the transformation, which was started back in 2006, was absolutely imperative for the success of certainly Royal Brisbane, and I'm led to believe from Richard's comments from PA. So it was a very instrumental period of change. It was just a time when the system was clearly broken, and as a change agent who had the confidence of Uschi Schreiber, I was able to get that through as a very satisfying part of my life. And then I went from there in mid-2010 to work for the statewide services under Peter Lewis Hughes, doing benchmarking projects in radiology, but mainly based in Medication Services Queensland, with Di Alders, who was the boss of that, who very kindly recruited me, and we brought in a lot of the clinical change methods which she had funding to do, including getting all the pharmacists together as a monthly meeting, in the same way that the directors of medical services were meeting monthly for support, for sharing, and basically benchmarking how they're all providing their services. So that was a very important and useful time. We received funding from the state government to run a range of lean projects. By then I'd become a black belt in both lean and Six Sigma. And so with Mike O'Connor, the consultant I used consistently from Melbourne, who was ex-Toyota, we were quite a powerful team, with my being interface with executive and he being on the ground, the technician, doing the flow charting, brainstorming and so on. So we went through about 20 or so hospitals, pharmacy departments across the state, and put in various lean projects into pharmacy, including rural Brisbane, Rockhampton, Mackay and so on, PA, Gold Coast, and they became demonstration sites of what lean could look like in a busy pharmacy, as good as any place to start. We had made a start in emergency departments, and particularly at Royal Brisbane, where another video describes the success we had in turning Access Block into better flow, replicating the work that Professor Tony Brown, who's now the Professor of Emergency at Royal Brisbane, we coincidentally had done the same work in 1986 at Royal North Shore, at that stage based on common sense rather than lean, which hadn't been coined as a term then, but looking back it was very similar. Good common sense management. You've got to empty the emergency department before you take in the elective patients, and principles like that, which make a lot of sense. So that's really a quick summary of the period 1991 to 1990, mid 97, which was, I think, looking back, probably my most influential period in Australian healthcare. During this time also, I was being frequently invited to New Zealand by the Royal Australian College of Physicians branch over there, and I did several study tours to the physicians talking about this shift in quality, which was very interesting, hosted by my good friend Professor John Buchanan, who was based in Auckland and at the same time doing consulting work for the largest hospital in New Zealand, which was Auckland Hospital, otherwise known as A+, under Marie Caldwell and Michael Sagidotti, who were the leadership team. For several years, that was a very productive time of my life, having got the principles through the ACHS, now going out and giving advice to big hospitals on how they could apply it and make some sense of it, and not be scared by it, not to be mystified by it, and encouraging them to visit the US, often in with my study tours, to be able to see the reality and come back. One of the things which made that difficult was that the various governments kept a strong focus on costs.
Yeah, look, great to see you. You haven't changed a bit, mate.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, we have. Oh, no, you haven't. No, it's really good. And I have fond memories of our time together, which, and that's the period I'd like to cover today, because I have great memories of when I left North Shore and then went to the Health Roundtable. There was about a 6-year gap in my version of the story, which must be true, right?
right. Yeah. I've been thinking about it in the last few days. The first time we met was I did a certificate of quality management in healthcare. You were teaching.
Yeah, tell me about that, because I want to include that, because that was part of my campaign to get TQM's.
That's right.
Top of the head. No, look, just top of the head.
Let me just see if I find my CV. But that certificate was run by, was accredited by University of New South Wales.
Correct. And the ACHS.
And the ACHS, that's right.
And so,
I reckon I did that in about 1991.
You were one of the first in, I think. And that was part of my strategy to get a workforce out there who are across this. And many people like you probably were, but it needed some formalisation. So it was a six-month course.
Yeah, that sounds about right. And a couple of residential workshops, I think. Yeah.
Distance learning, and there's at least, I think there's a beginning and an end workshop, which we held in Sydney.
That's right. In Adelaide, from memory.
Adelaide might have been it. And I brought out one of the US.
It wasn't Adelaide. It was in Sydney, but it was in on the coast somewhere.
Well, no, it was in Sydney. We always did it at the on the harbour in Sydney. There was an old Catholic seminary type thing. The ACHS were always saving money, so they, rather than get a decent hotel, they put us up in that. Anyway, it didn't matter. It was all part of the bonding experience.
But it was.
I'm glad. So that was
that was pivotal for me. That was the start of it all for me, really, in quality.
Excellent.
And I didn't get it at first because we're talking about a quality cycle. I thought, we already do the quality cycles. The difference was we were looking for issues and then fixing them. We weren't focusing on the single measure and improving it over time. Yeah. I still say to people, that's not continuous improvement.
Exactly.
Improving things all the time is not continuous improvement. Continuous improvement is picking a single measure and improving it over time.
Exactly. No, you got it. No, that was a very important part of getting the message spread across the country. We took it to, the ACHS advertised it. It was their program. I was their inaugural director. And I got a grant from the insurance company in New South Wales to fund my time there.
So, all right.
So I'm glad that was a, because they were, the Treasury-managed fund, who were our insurers for the hospitals, basically funded my time to run that. And so it cost the ACHS nothing. I'm glad you found that useful. And I've had some pretty good feedback about it. It only ran for 2 years because then the funding ran out. And like all good things, without funding, it possibly could have kept going on a self-funding basis, but the ACHS were very conservative, and without some sort of backing, they just wouldn't do it. So I moved to other things and went back into hospitals. But now I'm glad you're part of that, and I really want to thank you mainly for your hosting my visits at the kids' hospital.
That's all right. They were good days.
It was such a privilege for me too, because the Royal Kids was and still is, and probably the premier hospital in the country, really, I would think, in terms of its overall standard.
Yeah, it's a great time of my life working there, and I ended up working about 21 years there.
Wow.
Including my nursing training. So I've tried to fill in a few gaps. I've struggled a bit, but...
You go. I'll
I did that course first, and then somewhere on the line I started travelling to the US. I think... At least some of them were Institute for Healthcare Improvement courses that I'd done. I think that was the first one. I went over and did an intensive. Can't remember the name of the woman that ran it. And see her as plain as day. But anyway, I started going over there and doing those courses and going to the conferences and stuff like that. I got that all from you, and I had been reading all those books. So from the early days. From that course, I started reading, Deming stuff, and I had a book called "Better Than a Known, Safer Than a Known Way" by John McConnell. Remember that book?
Yeah, I do. Yeah,
had all the statistical process control and all that sort of stuff in there. I've still got that book, and some really great lessons about customer is king, but the customer doesn't know all.
I know.
Fantastic stuff. I still use all that stuff. I still use it in my, even though I've been in operations management now since about 1998, I still use all that stuff in my day-to-day.
That's great to hear.
I recently presented to our board here at Melbourne City Mission for the first time about some issues we're having with one of the programs financially. And I started telling them about common cause variation, special cause variation. I said, you don't want to be jumping at all of the special cause variation. That's where we need contingency plans. But if you want to change the system, you change it for common cause variation. And they loved it.
Yeah.
They thought it was fantastic. It was good for me because I was teaching them to get off my back, you see, every time there was an aberrant result in the finances.
That's fantastic. No, it's still true today, isn't it?
Oh, it's the best stuff. And, I just haven't forgotten any of that stuff. I remember the
Out of the Crisis.
Yeah, no, but he had a little I've forgotten what it was called.
The saying, a book, or
the value, customer value chain, or something.
Yep. Well,
remember that?
Well, that was also Gene Nelson. Gene Nelson had the clinical value compass.
Oh, the clinical value compass I use all the time.
Yeah, that was.
So there was stuff there. Yeah, there was Gene Nelson. There was Michael Pugh.
Pugh came out, yeah, and we had.
Michael. Yeah.
David and, Gustafson came out. Gustafson came out too.
Yeah, Gustafson, great guy, Dave.
He was fantastic.
I actually wrote to him a few times.
Yeah, no, he's an excellent. He was excellent value.
Oh, he was great. He's remember still, he had that thing called CHESS?
Yeah.
Comprehensive health education support.
Yep.
That was ahead of its time, you know. And
oh, it was. A lot of it was. And we had Paul Batalden come out a little later. You may not have seen him. And then.
A lot later,
the ACHS brought out and the New South Wales government brought out Don Berwick. But by then, I'd moved on. But All this stuff helped create the
environment. Yeah, that was after my time.
Yeah, me too. But
I'm
really delighted to hear that, Sean, that it's had some impact on your career and has been helpful. Because
it's been really helpful. There's two things. There's two things that I did at the Children's which were lasting changes that still happen.
Yeah.
The first was the implementation of the patient safety program, which was started with the reviews of deaths.
Excellent.
And that came from the limited adverse occurrence screening that Wolf, what was his name?
Alan Wolf
at Wimmera Base Hospital.
He pioneered.
I got that from you, yeah.
Well, he took it from me and made it easier.
That's right. So he did it. You took the raw North Shore stuff and taught it to him, and then he changed it.
And he based it on the discharge codes.
So they do that. They still do patient safety and adverse event screening there. They still do it. Annie Molden ran that for years.
Yep.
Dr. Molden. And then the other thing was the medical emergency team.
Yes.
That was Ken Hillman's work at Liverpool Hospital.
Liverpool.
I remember you and I, we brought him out to do grand rounds.
Yep.
And we met with the doctors afterwards and they said, won't work.
Yep, that's right.
Won't work. Frank Shannon in intensive care said, nah, won't work, pediatrics. there's nothing, you know. And it took 7 years to get that off the ground, 7 years.
Wow.
And in the end, it was another guy whose name escapes me, came to me in after a coroner's case. He says, this is the thing you've been talking about? I said, yeah. And he goes, I think we can do it.
Wow.
And they did. So we did it. And that ended up saving lives. And they're the only things I did that are still there.
Those two alone justify.
I mean, they
justify your time there because that very important quality and safety issues. So well done, and it's and you had to pioneer as I did too, getting it through the docks, which was never easy. And even in a place like Kids and Royal North Shore, where you're thinking of being, of course they'd go to quality, but they had this belief system that we're doing everything right already. So what's your problem?
What I don't remember is how the first time that you came to the Children's came about.
I remember that. Look, there was a nurse who used to, was it Elizabeth? I can't think of her name, but there was a strategic planning type nurse, some sort of nurse coordinator. She had blondish hair and she heard me talk at some conference I was at. And she was kind of, I think she reported to Ivor Davies, I think, which she was very, very helpful in getting me to come and meet with Ivor and you guys and just present my wares. And so I did that. And she was there and then she handed me over and then you took over the sort of hosting of my visits.
Right.
She was still there in the background and I'm just... can't think of a name now, but
I don't know who that was.
She moved on eventually to be a CEO of a little hospital up in North Melbourne. Up in the rural areas, and I lost.
Yeah, I don't know what that was.
I remember
when John DeCampo took over. We did a lot of work together with John.
Yep.
We did the there's a few things. They're not in order, but we did the we did some strategic planning stuff.
Yep, did that exactly. Yep.
We did the integrated quality management model.
Model, that's right.
Ill-fated in integrated quality
management. Yeah, and that all fell over when the Commonwealth started to mistrust John DeCampo. I mean,
yeah.
You know, too
much managing up, and he pulled the pin.
But they basically called him in and gave him a dressing down. Now, the guy's doing it for nothing. You know, he's doing it as part of his elite hospital. And John was quite rightly so incensed, as he should have been.
What was that about? Because I wasn't privy to that.
I was told that that they weren't happy with some parts of the program, and I never knew what they were. They didn't come to me. I was the operator. They went on and cast aspersions on John's management somehow, that they insulted John, which you just you don't do. And so, I mean, if they'd been criticising me, John were racing with me, but they somehow criticised John. And so John just called me and said, look, I can't work with them. They're just not collaborating. The typical government, that they just wanted to find fault. And said, I'm out of here. And then the Commonwealth said to me, well, do you want to take over the whole program? And initially, I said, look, quite frankly, if you can't work with John and I haven't got great confidence you can work with me. And it won't be long until you're, whatever the issue was. And no one ever told me. So I've got no idea what their beef was, except that they maligned John DeCampo, which was a foolish thing to do. And I don't blame John at all for saying that, okay, I'm out of here. And they were prepared to let me run the whole thing. And I said, well, you know, you need to have a team concept. And I said, I've often regretted that. I think I probably could have made it work with, if I had a chat to them saying, look, you know, what's your problem? And let's work through whether we can solve it together. But I was just so aghast that they would attack John DeCampo. I just defended him and said, well, if you can't work with John DeCampo, you couldn't work with anybody, seriously, because he was such an easygoing guy. Yeah. And it was pretty hard to upset him, but they did.
Yeah, he was a good guy, John, really good guy.
They really upset him, and I thought, well, that's if I took it on, it would be a matter of time until they're gunning for me, which is to say, if I have time again, I'd probably workshop it with them and say, well, let's build in some ground rules here. This is a tough program, you know. I'm happy to love it. But anyway, so I just said, no, look, if you don't want to do it, then they just closed the whole thing down, which rather than coming to see me and saying, well, let's try to revive this, which we could have done, but I didn't detect enough goodwill. I mean, it was Jerry Van Dyke.
I remember any of it.
He was the guy who, anyway, look, but then that was 1996.
And was that? Okay.
It was 1996 when they got narky about that. We closed it down, and then I was sort of regrouping, where do I go now? And a year later, I joined the Health Round Table.
That's right.
Because I picked
that up. That sounds about right, because I wasn't on the Health Round Table.
So that's about
six years. I reckon I did that course in about 1990.
Well, no, 1991 was the first year. The first year was
91. Okay, so 1991.
I think you were one of the first in that first group. Yeah. And then we basically closed it down. We ran for 2 years, and then that was the length of the grant. It could have gone on. But the ACHS weren't exactly easy to work with or for, but it certainly got the word out there, and that was my whole intention, that there was a big shift going on from QA to
CQI. Yeah.
And because the ACHS were running this course with an inaugural director of quality management, that got every hospital in the country. So and then we did the courses. And then I was running all these study tours to the USA too for executives.
Yeah.
Did that for
five of those. That was right.
And you and I went over at least in 1996, we funded a contingent from the IQM to go to the annual forum. That was 96.
And 96, right.
And so we met up with a whole lot of the gurus over there.
But, yeah, and we went to the network of networks.
Exactly. We went to that, and it was exciting times. You know,
they were great times. In 1998, I moved into operations.
Okay.
But I remember, so you started as Duncan Stuart and Associates, and then later on, Healthier Outcomes Network International.
Yeah, that's right. I
was moving into operations by then.
Because I was very keen to. I'd seen that the US had these networks of collaborating hospitals.
Yeah.
And I came back quite interested in setting them up here. And I started that it was about 1996, probably 97. And then just by absolute chance, I heard this guy called David Dean, who was just starting the Health Roundtable. Talk at Liverpool Hospital. And I went out there just to a public lecture. And he was describing very much the same sort of model. He already got going with teaching hospitals, and they were only adult hospitals, but they didn't have any capacity for pediatric hospitals, which is why that came a fair bit later. But when they started it, it was purely adult public hospitals. So I just said to him, David, look, I was going to start one of these, but why don't we collaborate? And at the time, he didn't have anybody with a medical quality safety. I mean, my CV, he often says, was an exact complementary to what he has, because he was a change agent, a very good one too.
Yeah.
And so we just, in the middle of that year, 97, I joined them and stayed with them for nearly almost 20 years and just set up and that became a vehicle for getting it out there, even though initially they weren't that fussed about patient safety. It took a few years until patient safety bubbled up to the top of the pile, because David's approach was, which I've learned a lot from him, you know, rather than pioneering it, which I tried to do, which is bloody hard work. I mean, you're trying to be the lead change agent, you just can't.
Yeah.
David said, no, we wait until the chief executives, who are all members of his board, wait until they want it. Wait until they want patient safety, then we
will.
Which is pretty smart. You've got to be quite patient, and I wasn't that patient. But he basically, and once it got onto the national agenda, which it did towards the end of, you know, towards 2000, somewhere about there, 1999, patient safety had become, because Bernie Harrison and Ross Wilson published their MJA article about screening for adverse events.
Yeah.
And that further gave it academic rigor as to we've got a lot of problems here. And then the CEO picked up, and then the round table got behind it. And we ran a whole lot of patient safety meetings, again, all limited to adult teaching hospitals.
Yeah.
Until we set up the regional adult hospital group. But unfortunately, and the kids' hospitals didn't come on board for a lot longer, because you had your own association, you had your own grouping, we didn't want to sort of have a big fight stealing you. So, but look,
yes. What was the name of that guy? I think he was involved in the IQM. He was an anesthetist, and he had developed this incident reporting.
Bill Runciman. Bill
Runciman, the real ornery fellow.
Bill Runciman from the Royal Adelaide Hospital.
And he started the Patient Safety Foundation.
He started that, and one of the many mistakes, because I was still learning change, and I'm still learning how to change, but my thinking was that to get as many people who had a stake in quality into a group, which would be the steering committee for the whole program.
Yeah.
And Bill was one of them. There were a couple of hospitals. Clearly, the Royal Children's was the lead site. But I thought if I can get people like Bill Runciman, and there's somebody from Campbelltown Hospital, a range of people.
I remember her. There was a woman there.
who were doing stuff. Now, the problem was they all wanted money. I said, look, you know, I've got this, I turned the phone off, it's talking to me. I said, we've got this opportunity that if we can get this set up and make you all sort of the demonstration sites, you know, there'll be, the money will flow after that. But I had $1 million all up. And I said, I can't give you all the sort of money you want. Well, that was what, if I was doing it again, what I would have done, and it's obvious to me now from my studies in change, is we should have made the kids' hospital the exemplar. We should have got in there and said, right, let's just make the lead hospital, which was you, the exemplar for the country, and invite people like Bill and all the others and Alan Wolf and it to basically have just come along and guide that, but not expect them to be funded to set up their own little version of it, because that was too ambitious. So anyway, lived and learned. And
I just remember another thing now. This was on the side, but I had to, there was a state government did something about patient safety, and it named Children's Hospital and some other hospitals as demonstration sites or sites for other hospitals to contact if you wanted some guidance in setting stuff up. And I had to go and present to this forum at the department, and there was, you know, medical chiefs and all that sort of stuff. And I rang Alan Wolf.
Yeah.
I said, I've got to do a presentation. What do you think I should put in it? We nutted it out. And he said, there's one thing you've got to put in those slides. He said, if you keep doing this, sooner or later you're going to come across an individual practitioner issue. We focus on the systems and systems just culture, but sooner or later you're going to come across an individual practice issue. And I went along and I presented that stuff and everyone was loving it. Except for Paddy DeWan. Remember Paddy DeWan?
Yeah.
Paddy DeWan was a pediatric surgeon and he's in the front row shitting on me, saying the numbers didn't stack up and the small samples and, you know, it wasn't research and all sorts of stuff. So it's not about that. It's about identifying systems that we can improve, and here's the examples of the things we've done. Anyway, he turned out to be the one, the individual practice.
Right.
He got sacked from the Children's, and then he got sacked from the Sunshine Hospital, then he got sacked from Barwon Hospital.
Wow.
Yeah. For
excellent.
Basically being a bit of a cowboy, operating outside of the norms and doing things that other surgeons wouldn't support. Not sure what he ended up doing, but he ran a really strong public relations campaign, but in the end he was toast.
Yeah, no, I had the same sort of thing happen at Royal North Shore. The people who had most to fear were the most opposed to. And luckily, there were enough people there eventually who were the good guys, as you had too. There's enough good guys to carry it through, but the guys who are threatened by it make it very hard. No, it was a wonderful time. I really enjoyed that period.
They were good days.
Working.
I still use it all. I use the Clinical Values Compass all the time. I talk about systems and multidimensional outcomes. So you've got to have the multidimensional outcomes, including cost, and the cost is a function of delivering these outcomes.
Yep.
People love that. Boards love that one. And I still talk about the little pearls of wisdom that Michael Pugh gave us from, was it something Pablo?
He was in Colorado. The he was chief executive of the
San Pablo or something like that.
San Pablo Health Hospital. He was one of the most inspiring because he was in a CEO role.
Yeah, and he was super pragmatic. Remember, he came up with the annual piece of paper?
That's right.
For appraisals.
That's right.
Said, what are you going to have? They said, you've got to have a piece of paper. You've got to sit down. He goes, all right, fine. They come up with the annual piece of paper. That's what do you like about your job? What would you improve? What are your objectives for next year?
Yeah,
it was fantastic.
He was amazing. Now, Michael, I visited him a few times and we ended up taking a group to his hospital, and he was just, everything he said was real.
He was gold.
He was gold. I kept in touch with him for a while, but I've lost contact now. I'm trying to find these guys again, just say hello to them. But
happened to what ended up happening with Don Berwick? Did he keep going?
Don Berwick was offered a job with the federal Medicare program. He went into that Medicare, so he left the IHI. It was under Obama, because Obama was very pro Berwick, obviously, as you'd expect. Yeah. And he went in there and tried to do a lot of reforms, probably quite ambitious, as we change agents tend to do, and made a lot of enemies, and they ended up getting rid of him, which was just, you know, that's what happens. You know, the vested interests, like you struck with Paddy, and like I had a few of those always gunning.
Oh, yeah.
And Don, you know, with Don's incredible credentials and experience running the Medicare program and saying we're going to build quality funding, and they eventually, after a year or a couple of years, he survived, and then they got him to stand down. So he couldn't go back to the IHI. He passed that on to Marie Bazignano.
She's the one that did my course. Yeah, that's the one, Marie.
She's very good. I think she's still running it. But Don became, I mean, he was by then, he had plenty of consulting work. He just could
work
the whole time consulting. And he still sought after as a keynote speaker at their national conferences.
So, and he's a great speaker.
Oh, he's
a great speaker.
He's just unique. You know, he'd speak from the heart and he'd speak from his own experiences. And every I went to most of those conferences in the 90s, and he'd always come back. It was the highlight of the whole conference.
Oh, he was so good. The one that you and I went to,
96.
He did this one about running to space. You remember that?
And that's right. He
scored the soccer team.
That's right. That's
the coach of the soccer team who's trying to teach the girls to run to space instead of following the ball. And every time he'd say, and this is me on the sidelines, and he was sitting back in the banana lounge with his coconut and his drink and everything, his sunglasses and his hat on. He's a funny guy, you know. He's so, and he knew how to play to an audience. He was great. He was such a, he was so inspiring.
I did a deal with the ACA, with the IHI to get all those tapes. We got a recording of all of his plenary sessions, and I used to distribute them in Australia because people were using them to basically support their education programs. Because you go and pick 10 minutes out of his talk and that'd be a whole workshop you could run around.
Oh, for sure.
No, Don was amazing. I must say, when I first met him, he started my whole move from QA to CQI, and I'm going to put this in this video and put it together. But his 1989 opinion piece in the New England Journal, on the 5th of January, he basically described how healthcare could run, and he said, you know, I'm prepared to. This is how it could look. This is how now looking inspection based. Here it looks. It's an article still worth reading. It's still current. So, but then I went off the next year to go and meet him in Boston when he was just getting going, and. We've stayed in touch in various ways ever since, and saw the IHI just grow from its initial name was the National Demonstration Project, but it improved.
That's right.
IHI, and Don took on.
Yeah, I had that book.
Role, and it was a totally exciting time to be around, and it's a bit like it was just fabulous to be around healthcare when the IHI was born, and
it was,
and then to. And I told them, look, I'm going to use all your materials and to inform my course. And they were cool about that. They said, if you for conferences, the materials are yours. Just acknowledge where you got them from, which I did.
Yeah.
And because they wanted the whole thing to spread worldwide anyway. So that was just, and then bringing out their gurus, you know, like people we've mentioned, kept Don informed that we were trying to do the best we could. On a relative shoestring compared to what they had, but anyway, it was enough to give for 2 years. And it warms my heart to know that people like you and others I've spoken to, you know, just doing one of the courses was enough to kind of plant enough seeds to get you going and give you a bit of paper too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I use it all the time. I still think in systems all the time. I remember I went to a guy at the children's, Steve Furman, who was operations manager for a while, who's a nice guy. I said, I don't understand accruals. What's an accrual? He goes, well, an accrual is this. And he goes, so, you know, at home you you have your insurance or your registration that comes at the end of the year, and it's a big hit.
Yeah.
Because imagine if your rent was like that. Because instead of having a rent as an annual payment, you have it as a monthly or a fortnightly or whatever, and you can budget for that expense and keep it flat. Because that's what an accrual is. Accrual is accruing money to pay the big bills so that you don't have these massive expenses. And you can do it for income as well. I said, oh, that's special course, common course. Straight away, right?
Yeah.
And okay, now I understand it. You've got to keep it within the control limits. Whatever they are. and that's still how I think. I still, all that stuff, I've never, ever forgotten it.
That's fantastic, John. Good on you, mate. No, likewise, you know, I went on from there, and it sort of evolved into lean, you know, lean thinking, and
lean, yep.
But it was all part of the same stuff, and it was just the
Toyota
had just refined it down to a sharp point, which was lean, and I went out and became an advocate for that, and got my black belt in lean and Six Sigma, and kept doing that, and right up until the end when I finally gave healthcare the boot. In 2012, but you know, it was a fabulous quality journey, and it's people like
me
and the others who picked it up and as you're describing, ran with it, that helped it become a reality in this country.
Absolutely. Good days.
We all became change agents, and as you're describing, and it needed that. So While there was a few errors made in the IQMM, it was too ambitious looking back. But anyway.
Way too ambitious.
Well, and way underfunded. You know, if I'd met David Dean earlier, David would have been fabulous to help on the change side of that and the CEO negotiations. But anyway, it didn't happen. So,
you know what else I remember? I just remembered something else. I don't know what it was, but we did some strategy stuff at the children's end. We presented it to the executive and we written it up, and it was pretty brief. It was like maybe 8 to 12 pages. But the front page, it was something catchy.
We'll do what we said we'd do. It was a lot.
Right. And then at the bottom we asked the questions, which were, who are our customers? What do they want? Are we giving them what they want? Are we improving? How do we know?
That's right, and I think the phrase you're referring to is something along the lines, which, well, let's do what we said we'd do.
Yeah.
Planning's supposed to do. And then if we're going to promise this stuff, let's make sure that we remain honest to that. And that came out of those planning workshops, which was a great outcome. And you know, and people like Duran always said that quality must start with strategic planning. Which is right. You've got to have it all built in as part of the main business, and not as some peripheral thing that used to be in the QA days. But we got so close. You know, we got so close, and you know, if we could have just kept the Commonwealth to behave themselves, who knows? But I think if we were doing a revision at that time, I think my suggestion would have been, okay, this is too ambitious. Let's defer. The all the hospitals who are hangers on, focus on the kids, get that going as an exemplar, and now I know from change management and the theory of spread, you've got to have a good one exemplar, which we didn't have, and I had about five or six going at once, which was too ambitious. But anyway, so that was my lesson learned. But and so Health Roundtable, we certainly did that. We made sure that. It was all about innovation spread, and we made sure that whenever we wanted to spread something, we had one exemplar who would become the lead model with practical how to do it advice.
Yeah,
and that was so much more successful, and based on the theory of change, which was a bit light on for the IQMM. But anyway, look, it's wonderful. So look. That's been fabulous, Sean. Thank you. I will take little quotes from this, and I'll send it to you before I put it out there. But I wanted to fill in that gap between 1991 and 1997, which was probably my.
And you were doing other hospitals as well. You were doing a lot of, you know, traveling around and working with hospitals on patient improvement projects.
I was working in Auckland. I was working for the biggest hospital, A+. I was working. in Adelaide for the private hospital over there, St Andrews, and yeah, a range of other hospitals.
I remember meeting some people over there. I think it was Parks where Kathy Alexander was working.
Yes, that's right. No,
we met the guys who had developed the scoring software for the SF-36.
Yes. Yeah, no, it was probably the most powerful time.
What happened to that, by the way?
What?
It sort of just died out, SF-36. It was really popular for a while, that sort of...
Well, I've searched it recently, and it's still out there, but it's been... There's an SF-12, which was around then.
Yeah.
The 36 was, unless you had an incentive to measure that. And I've written to one of the... Who was it now? The federal government are now saying they want to build outcomes into health funding.
Yeah, they call them PREMs and PROMs now.
Well,
patient-reported experience, patient-reported outcomes.
Something like that, that they want to build something in. But think about occasionally doing a sample of the SF-12. I think that they already had something, you know, the outcomes measures from Bataan that they picked up. And I think New Zealand's got a version of it too.
Right, and then they did the validation of the child health questionnaire, which was the child health version of the SF-36. Elizabeth Waters and her team at Children's did that validation.
Okay.
Do you remember Liz Waters?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. She died, I don't know how long ago now, maybe about 5 years ago.
Okay,
I was CEO briefly at a community health service in Victoria for a couple of years. And someone was working on something, and I said, there's a woman, Elizabeth Waters, she's Professor Brockhoff Professor at the Children's Such and Such Melbourne Uni, go and have a talk to her. And we went out there and we met with her and we had a chat. She goes, you did all the scoring for the child health questionnaire, didn't you? I said, yeah. She goes, oh, man, that was like a lifetime ago. And then I thought about her a few years later and I looked her up. She had died. She died of breast cancer, I think.
Well, Alan Wolfe has died too. Did you know that?
Oh, really? No, I didn't know.
Alan died last year, and we've got less than a minute to go. I thought I had unlimited Zoom, but it might cut us off, in which case I think we've got most of it, but I don't want to take more time. But if I'll come back to you if we need more. But if it all goes blank, the Zoom has now got – I thought it was unlimited for just two people.
That's right.
But they tightened it up. But Alan died of a brain tumour. I interviewed him like this about the work we did on the MMA, and it's that's now available. And he died about 2 months later. So I'm glad. Wow. I'm glad I got that. But
I think Alan's impact. You know, when it comes to Alan Wolf.
Yep.
And your work, obviously, but in Alan's absence, and after listening to your interview with Alan, which was a fantastic interview, by the way.
Thank you.
I've been thinking about his impact and we copied his work and he knew that because we got from the IQMM.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I started implementing that at the Children's employed Colin Feakery, the paediatrician, to do death reviews, and then secondarily Annie Molden, and Dr. Annie Molden took the money and implemented that limited adverse occurrence screening. The Children's modified it slightly, of course. And just like Alan's experience, in the end, it was the clinicians coming to them and saying, I've got this case.
Yep.
Before they had to worry about picking it up through medical records review, clinicians were self-reporting and saying, there's an issue with this case. I wasn't very happy with it, or I noticed something in this one. And I think... You know, we weren't the only ones who copied it, and certainly we were a demonstration site or a reference site for patient safety in Victoria, and a number of hospitals contacted Annie Molden and to check out what we were doing, and they copied it. So I think that,
excellent.
You know, Alan's, yeah, exactly. And I think, you know, that saved lives. There's no doubt about it.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
The work that you did and the work that Alan did saved lives. And, you know, I wish I had a chance to talk to Alan about it before he died, because I'm not sure he really knew the impact that he'd had across Australia.
No, probably not. He had, I don't know, people contacted him. He had a bit of an idea, but whether he had the full idea, I don't know.
Yeah. So I was thinking of actually getting in touch with his partner, who's working in Melbourne at the moment, just to pass on my thanks to her on it. But yeah, no, Alan was a good guy, and I think you know he was just a doer. He made things happen, right?
Quiet achiever. He was
absolutely the quiet achiever.
He was very very quiet in his persuasion, but he was very effective.
No, oh, absolutely.
Absolutely. He caught on to things very quickly. You know, he just he came up to our seminars in 1988, which I was running at the Royal North Shore, and just immediately got it. And
got, yes.
But he got the potential to streamline it, which it needed.
Absolutely. And I think from memory, I'm pretty sure we used medical record screening to flag the records. And that was perfect, wasn't it, really?
Yeah.
So the fact that he's Don knocked him back and said, no, just, you know, I don't have the nurses for it. And then he thought, oh, well, or maybe she said, we'll use the medical record stuff. They've got a bit of talent, you know.
Yeah.
And, of course, in Victoria, they were screening records already because of case mix funding.
Exactly.
So it was a perfect storm.
It was. No, it was. And Victoria was best set up because of case mix funding. People were...
Yeah.
The records were more detailed than other states who weren't doing case mix funding, and therefore they weren't bothering much with getting accuracy of the coding.
So, yes. So I had to figure a lot of this stuff much thought over the years, because in 1998 I was appointed director of the Division of Medicine alongside Peter McDougall. So the whole hospital structure in those days was there was a medical director who worked part-time and a nurse who worked full-time, and they worked as a team to head up the division. And the Division of Medicine was the largest division of the Children's Hospital. And Peter McDougall ended up chairing the Patient Safety Committee. Excellent. And he had experience. He was on the Victorian neonatal death committee, and they would review every neonatal death in Victoria. And I think that the work that we did helped both ways, because we had focused less on individual practice and more on systems.
Okay.
So I think he was able to take that back.
Right.
So yeah, perfect time.
Yeah, that's great.
I haven't spoken to Alan since that phone call when I rang him up about the presentation I was doing, and he gave me some tips, and that's a long time ago now. So.
Yeah.
It's probably at least 20 years. Wow. So I was very sad to hear that he died, and I missed the chance. But I hadn't given a lot of thought to that work until you contacted me. So
okay, good. Well, that's great to hear.
I didn't think about it all.
So I could add this also to the end of the MMA interview with Alan.
Yeah.
I think that what you've just said would fit very well there, but also here. So I'll edit into maybe a bit of it into both. But you're right. His partner, I've never met his partner, but I've got her email address, and I've sent that interview to. And in fact, her email address was their email address. So I did send.
Right.
I did send Alan that in. So he's seen that interview we did, and I think he said he was happy with it. These are the way it came out, because it was probably one of the rare records of him just kind of commenting on just what happened and where it all started. And so he's written a few articles, but it was good to have an interview.
Yeah.
So yeah, again, by all means, if you so I'll add this as best I see fit to one or both of the those interviews, and just because it does, I think, add a sense of completeness that what you've just said, that the extension of it from within Victoria, that's something I didn't know about, and so that's always good to put on the record. So thanks for that.
Absolutely.